B here, and welcome back to Biology. Today, I'm visiting a team of scientists, paleontologists to be exact. What do you think they're doing out here, digging in the dirt? They're looking for fossils. Do you remember what a fossil is? Fossils can be any remains or traces of a once-living organism. Paleontologists study fossils to learn more about extinct organisms and to help piece together the puzzle of evolution. We'll look at how fossils form and how they are studied in today's lesson. But before we go fossil hunting, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to describe the process of fossil formation, determine the relative ages of fossils in rock layers, and determine the absolute ages of fossils using radioactive half-lives. Before we talk about how fossils form, it's important to note that when an organism dies and decomposes, in the vast majority of cases, fossils simply don't form. Fossil formation is definitely the exception, not the rule. For an organism to become a fossil after it dies, the condition and events surrounding it have to be just right. Far less than 1% of organisms are preserved at all after death, and most fossils that do form remain buried underground, where we can't see them. So, finding a fossil is a very unique and lucky occurrence. To see how a fossil might form, let's follow the journey of a dinosaur who has unfortunately just died in a river. The body sinks and is covered with sediment. The soft tissues of the dinosaur's body decomposes or is eaten by other animals. Its bones harden and become a fossil. Over time, the sediments surrounding it become rock. As the skeleton is compacted under the pressure of rock and sediment layers above. Eventually, geological forces in the earth raise the rock layer the dinosaur is buried in to the surface, and erosion may wear away the rock layers until the fossil becomes visible once again. A find like this will make our team of paleontologists very happy indeed. We tend to think of fossils as being bones, and this is because bones are the most likely body part to be preserved. However, other types of fossils are sometimes found. In rare cases, even the soft tissue of an organism can be preserved if the organism quickly becomes buried in ice, volcanic ash, or amber. In the lesson PDF, we'll compare this process to human mummification. These kinds of fossils can lead to a nearly perfectly preserved specimen with skin, hair, and other features still intact. Other fossils may not involve the remains of the actual organism, but give us insight into their activities and behaviors. Trace fossils, such as footprints, nests, burrows, and waste, can give paleontologists clues as to how long extinct organisms may have moved and raised young. These kinds of fossils often form when impressions made in mud or dirt quickly harden into rock and are preserved. Plants also frequently leave behind impression fossils that clearly show their leaf structure, even at a microscopic level. Impression fossils are any case of a print of any kind of organism being left behind. One of the most important pieces of information a paleontologist needs when studying a fossil is the age of the fossil. There are two methods of fossil dating that we'll talk about in this lesson. No, not that kind of dating. In relative dating, scientists can determine a fossil's age relative to other fossils. This is based on the principle that new layers of rock always form on top of older layers of rock, as sediment, mud, and lava are always deposited on top of the ground. They eventually harden to make new rock layers, burying the previous layer underneath. So fossils that are found in lower layers of rock will be older than the fossils found in higher layers of rock. If fossils are buried in layers of rock below the ground, how will we ever see them? Many won't be seen, at least not in our lifetime. But sometimes geology helps us out. The river may continue eroding the ground around it and carving a path deeper and deeper into the rock. At some point, many fossils that were buried in these layers become visible again. Where are the oldest fossils in this picture? Down in the bottommost visible rock layer near the riverbank. These fossils may have been buried for thousands or even millions of years. This information doesn't tell us exactly how many years old the fossil is, but we can sometimes use the location of a fossil in rock layers to assign a fossil to a specific geologic time period, based on the other fossils that were present in the same layer. In these rock layers, paleontologists have uncovered a gastropod of unknown age, but it was in the same rock layers as an ammonite fossil that is known to have gone extinct 66 million years ago, so it is reasonable to assume that the gastropod fossil is at least 66 million years old as well. And we can assume that the fossils in lower layers are older than this, and the fossils in higher layers are younger than this. This is how relative dating works. Index fossils, such as the ammonite fossil, are known to date to a particular time period and can therefore be used to establish relative ages of other fossils nearby. To be an index fossil, the fossil must be easily identifiable, widespread around the world, and have lived during a limited time period which is well defined. Trilobites are another example of an index fossil. These were marine organisms that lived in shallow seas around 500 million years ago. They fossilized easily because of their hard shell and are very easily recognizable. Any fossil found in the same layer of rock as these little treasures is known to be around the same age. When we accumulate all of the fossil information we have, this is known as the fossil record. It is an organized, ordered list that groups fossils by age into specific geologic time periods. You'll learn more about these time periods and which fossils are found in each in the next lesson. Scientists can use the fossil record to draw conclusions about how life has changed and evolved over time. Relative dating can tell us which organisms lived at the same time and put fossils in order from oldest to newest. But what if we want more quantitative data? Quantitative data involves numbers, and for this we will need to use absolute dating. Absolute dating can help us determine how many years it has been since the fossil formed, which tells us when the organism died. Absolute dating makes use of the process of radioactive decay. Some elements naturally break down into other elements over long periods of time at a predictable rate, like carbon into nitrogen once an organism dies. If we measure how much of the original element is in the organism and how much of the new element is present, we can tell how long the decay has been occurring. To calculate this, we will need to know the half-life of an element. This is the amount of time it takes for one half of the remaining sample to decay into the other element. In this example, we begin with 16 particles. After one half-life, there are only 8 remaining. After another half-life, notice the sample hasn't decreased to zero, but to one half of what was left after the first half-life. So now there are 4. The next half-life brings us to 2, and then 1. Theoretically, it will never go to 0, but at some point there isn't enough left to measure. A commonly used element for dating relatively young fossils is carbon-14. It decays into nitrogen-14 with a half-life of 5,730 years. When the organism that is going to become a fossil dies, it has 100% carbon-14 and no nitrogen-14. After 5,730 years, or one half-life, it is now composed of 50% carbon-14 and 50% nitrogen-14. After another 5,730 years, or two half-lives, it is now down to only 25% carbon-14 and 75% nitrogen-14. Another half-life brings us down to 12.5% carbon-14 and 87.5% nitrogen-14. After three half-lives, a total of 17,190 years have passed since the organism died and the fossil began to form. If these represented the percentages of carbon and nitrogen found in the fossil, this would indicate that it was 17,190 years old. Because carbon-14 has a relatively short half-life, it can only be used to date fossils younger than about 60,000 years old. After this time, not enough carbon-14 is left to accurately measure. For older fossils, we can use an isotope of potassium, which decays into argon in a similar process. However, potassium's half-life is 1.3 billion years. The Earth is around 4.5 billion years old, so potassium can be used to date even the very oldest fossils, which date back to around 3.5 billion years ago, and are cyanobacteria fossils found in Australia. In the lesson PDF, you'll have a chance to practice finding the age of fossils using radioactive dating. Let's try an example now to get you started. What if our fossil is found to contain 5 milligrams of carbon-14 and 15 milligrams of nitrogen-14? First, we find percentages. Our sample is 25% carbon-14 and 75% nitrogen-14. How many half-lives does this correspond to? You can find the percentages by starting with 100 and continuing to divide by 2, or you can use this handy chart. A split of 25-75 corresponds to two half-lives. So to find the age of our fossil, we multiply the half-life by 2. One half-life of carbon-14 is 5,730 years, so the fossil is 11,460 years old. Problem solved! As we went through the lesson today, we saw examples of fossils and learned how scientists can use both relative and absolute dating to find out how old they are. You'll find some more practice in the lesson PDF, and we'll take a look at the discovery of a woolly mammoth fossil. Be sure to check it out before you take the lesson assessment. Next time, we'll take a quick tour through the history of life on Earth and the periods of geologic time. Until then, remember that biology isn't just science, it's the way of life. See you next time! Hey, hey.